5:53 p.m. And today's question, as you might have been able to guess by that lovely intro, I know I'm such a talented dancer, is what is love? And that is a really big question. That is huge. I mean, there's countless of TV shows about it. There's millions of self-help books out there. The fact is that love is very hard to define, and I think its definition varies from person to person. The dictionary definition of love is a tender, profound, passionate affection felt towards someone else. Even that definition is vague, because does that mean that it's a soulmate type of love, that there's only one for me, that that's the only, I'm only going to be able to feel that kind of emotion towards one person in my lifetime, as some of these movies depict? There are different levels of love, and I think there's different interpretations of true love or romantic love.
What is it you want, Barry? What do you want? You want the moon? Just say the word and I'll throw a lasso around it and pull it down. Hey, that's a pretty good idea. I'll give you the moon, Barry.
I'll take it.
Up until the late 80s and into the early 90s, love was not really taken very seriously by scientists or anthropologists as far as to nail it down and get a clear, concise scientific definition of what love is. The reason for that being simply that, A, scientists are not very mushy, and they basically just saw love as this mushy, gushy thing that just went along with procreation and was simply there to encourage the reproduction and the continuation of our species. So, you know, to encourage sex, to all that good stuff, so that we can make babies and we can continue to live as humans on this planet. However, in the late 80s and into the 1990s, and even more so today, there were couples that were staying together and living together and having these committed relationships that had no children, and they were still in love. That kind of puts the idea that love is there to reinforce reproduction into question, because there's these couples that are having totally happy lives and they're totally in love with each other, and yet they're not reproducing. So that led scientists to their second hypothesis, which was that love was, these people were staying together out of societal pressure that was put upon them, and that so much of our media and everything in the Western society is so fueled by this idea of love. The romance movies, the love songs.
Love is all you need.
Wednesday, I don't care about you, it's Friday, I'm in love.
L is for the way you look at me. Oh, is for the only one I see.
I was in love and I had a blast. Then I found out he had a heart of glass.
Let my love open the door to your heart.
I mean, think about it. So scientists figured, okay, these people, they're not staying together because they're having kids. They're staying together because they feel pressured to find someone and get married. So they decided to put it to the test. And what they did is they investigated over 166 cultures worldwide, not just Western cultures, but Eastern cultures as well. Cultures that were totally opposite from us and had none of these pressures and this media aspect of love being thrust on them. And what they found is that in over 147 of these cultures that they studied, there was traces of romantic love there. It wasn't like ours, of course, it wasn't with the flowers and the candy and, you know, the diamond rings, but it was still there. That led to the discovery that
we are all born with the capability, and not only the capability, but predisposition to love.
As far as love goes for me personally, it's hard to say. I've been in love with the same guy for 4 years.
4 years. 4 years.
And there's another kind of love. The worst kind. The one that almost kills its victims. It's called unrequited love, and of that I am an expert. Most love stories are about people that fall in love with each other. But what about the rest of us? What about our stories? Those of us who fall in love alone. We are the victims of the one-sided affair. We are the cursed of the loved ones, the unloved ones, the walking wounded, the handicapped without the advantage of a great parking place. Yeah. It's not requited. He's just, you know, a friend. Kind of just like, it's almost been 5 years now. Almost 5 years. And I'm kind of just getting to that point where you're just kind of like, this is not meant to be, obviously. He's the closest thing I felt to love, and what that was It was amazing, you know? I don't know how to describe it other than electricity. It's like electric when you touch him. How he would say the stupidest things, and I would just think it was adorable. Like, oh my god, you're so ignorant. It's so cute. That sounds kind of bad. I remember we were at grocery store, and he was like, wait, this is albacore, and this says tuna. So what's the difference? They're different things? And I was just like, no, the hell? I don't know. I think love, you know when you're in love. It's like when you're really happy and you don't really have a reason for it and you're just, it almost hurts. Like, it hurts you're so happy and you don't even know why. Like, the things that would normally irritate you, they don't irritate you because nothing can really reach you when you're that happy.
You can't just buy me a guitar every time you screw up, you know.
Yeah, I know. But then, you know, there's always drums and bass and maybe even one day a tambourine.
A lot of my friends have told me that, you know, there's no such thing as real true love occurring for someone if those feelings are just one-sided. In other words, that the only way to experience true love is if the feelings are requited and returned, and that you're both, there's two people in the relationship, and that one person simply being in love with this other person who's totally denying them, that one person cannot truly be in love. On one hand, I have no strong argument against this because I have never been in a dually committed relationship. I've only been in love with someone from the outside and not being able to, you know, obtain them. So I could say that I feel very strongly for them, but when I am, or if I am, ever in a, like, dually committed relationship, I'll feel something much different, and it'll be much stronger, or it'll be real love, and I'll look back on my silly days of, remember those 4 years you wasted on that silly boy and you thought it was love? Oh, you silly child, that was simply a crush. So, I mean, maybe that'll happen, but at the same time, I find it so hard to believe that someone can't love another person without them returning the feelings. I don't believe that. I think that you can love someone and have them not return the feelings back.
I love the Smiths.
Sorry?
I said I love the Smiths. You've good taste in music.
You like the Smiths?
Yeah. To die by your side is such a heavenly way to die. I love them.
But basically what I know about love, I have learned from the media and movies. And I'm not talking about movies like The Notebook. I do not like The Notebook. I read the book and I saw the movie and I didn't like either of them. It feels so shallow to me.
Graham. One, two, three, four, I won't take no anymore. Five, six, seven, eight, I want you to be my mate. One, two, three, four, you're the one that I adore. Five, six, seven, eight, don't run from me, cause this is fate.
Breathe into my hands, I'll cut them like a glass to drink from.
Love you. Megan! You stop it this instant, because you will wallow in the squalor of your homosexual depravity for the rest of your life.